stick by you all the way through. Welcome back to Her Rules Radio. This is Alex Jameson, your hostess. So what's new here at Her Rules Radio? This is Love Week. Oh yeah, Valentine's Day coming on. Here it is. So how did I celebrate Valentine's Day? How do I do this? Well, I got to tell you, these kind of Hallmark card holidays don't, you know, we don't make a big fuss over them, but you know, I like to acknowledge the role of love in my life. And I went ahead and took a recent watercolor class from my favorite art teacher here in New York City. Shout out to Joan. And we had a blast. She had an afternoon watercolor class where we just focused on making really pretty personalized Valentine's Day cards. And it was so fun. And I remembered that, wow, art and creativity is something that just really helps me feel like I'm thriving. And it's a way to kind of lose yourself for hours in something fun, and it takes your mind off of things. You get into that beautiful flow state. So I want to encourage all my listeners to really pursue, spend time creating, doing things you enjoy, making, drawing, painting, cooking, gardening, whatever it is that lights you up creatively is a beautiful way to add energy to your life and reduce stress. So I had a great time making some Valentine's Day cards. You can see some of them over at my Instagram account. You can follow me at Delicious Alex. I'm going to post some for Valentine's Day, some of my heart cards. They're pretty cute, if I do say so myself. And I just got back from a quick weekend trip to Portland, Oregon to celebrate love, celebrate family, and visit my amazing 92-year-old grandma, Bushka, Mary Beth. We've called her Bushka my whole life. And she's, you know, she's fading a little bit. She's an amazing woman, 92. She's had such an incredible life. And I feel very fortunate that I've had her in my life this long and had her, you know, in my life at all. And you know, things are wrapping up for her. And I ran home to spend a weekend and spend a really sweet afternoon with her, really connecting with the people you love. That's what Valentine's Day is about. And should we do it more often? Yeah. But, you know, why not take this day, this week, this energy to really share what you appreciate and love about people? And that's what I was able to do. I'm so grateful that I was able to take that time and hop on a plane and go see her and spend time with my family in Oregon. So I hope you're able to do that too. But I know that love and relationship and marriages aren't always so rosy. And that's what today's episode is about. You know, it's easy to connect with the people that you know you love, you know you get along with, right? That's no big deal. Sharing your love with them, even sending a text like, hey, just thinking about you, I love you. That's great. What about the relationships that aren't going well? And as a little spin on Valentine's Day, we're actually going to be talking about the state of affairs in marriage, in committed long-term relationships. And on today's episode, I'll be interviewing Esther Perel about her latest book, The State of Affairs, and what infidelity means in this modern age, the new definitions of it, and how we can choose to heal either alone or together after infidelity. You know, it's really common. It happened in my first marriage and we were not able to repair that. And it took me years to heal after that. I've written about it. I've talked about it here on the show. And it affects so many of us. It's hard to talk about. And maybe there are people out there who are trying to make it work, right? Couples who infidelity has happened or it's ongoing, but they are dedicated to working it out. And it actually seems like it's looked down upon, right? To, you know, commit to your relationship after infidelity. You'll get so many people who are saying, you know, leave him. You don't deserve that kind of treatment. It's over, right? Anytime someone cheats, that's the end. Well, there's a lot of people who don't feel that way. There's actually, as Esther will say, there are lots of people who find that infidelity leads to a rebirth for a relationship. And her book is incredible, filled with stories about people she has worked with as a counselor over the years she has helped them find, rekindle, and recommit to their relationship. So I thought this was a really important topic. It's an incredible book. Esther has had several TED Talks that have been viewed by millions of people around the world. She has her own podcast. And actually, my husband Bob and I were lucky enough, because we have mutual friends, we were lucky enough to go see Esther ourselves at the beginning of our relationship, because we wanted help figuring out what our relationship was going to look like. We wanted someone who was super non-judgmental, who was open to, you know, really talking about our desires to create something unique and transparent, and a relationship that could evolve with us. And I had never done that before. I had never seen a counselor at the beginning of a relationship. And our one session with her, which I think was about 2 hours here in New York City, was super powerful and really helped us get clear about who we were, what we wanted together, and how we could create parameters as a couple that evolves together. So she's a pretty special woman. Her book, State of Affairs, is incredible. And I hope you'll listen all the way through to the end. And I'll wrap up with you in a bit. This week's episode of Her Rules Radio is brought to you by Lola. Lola is a modern approach to feminine care. Now, we care about the ingredients in the food we eat and the beauty products we use. Why shouldn't the same be true of our feminine care products? What are you using for your periods? Lola is a female-founded company offering a line of organic cotton tampons, pads, and liners. And they started their company with a very simple and seemingly obvious idea. Women shouldn't have to compromise when it comes to feminine care products. Lola products are 100% natural and 100% easy to feel good about. Unlike major brands, Lola offers complete transparency about the ingredients found in their tampons, pads, and liners. And Lola products are 100% cotton with no added chemicals, fragrances, synthetics, or dyes. And here's what's super awesome. You can pick your own products and have them delivered straight to your door with whatever frequency you want. You get to decide how many boxes you want every month. You get to decide if you want an assortment of tampons, what kind of pads you want, what kind of liners, etc. Your assortment is totally customizable. And it comes right to your door whenever you want it. So maybe you want it every 25 days, every 32 days. You can do that. Now, the FDA doesn't require brands to disclose a comprehensive list of ingredients in their feminine care products, so most of them don't. Lola products are 100% organic, and they tell you everything that's in them. This is so important. And their subscription is super flexible. You can change, skip, or cancel at any time. This is a founded company by women for women. So I have really loved the convenience and quality of Lola. I've got them in my bathroom right now. So I want you to go try this out. Go to mylola.com, mylola.com/rules40 to get 40% off your first order. Again, mylola.com/rules40. That gets you 40% off. You should totally give it a try. I really encourage you to share this with any young women in your life, especially who are just starting out. You know, young women do not need all those hormonal issues that can come with synthetic fragrances and dyes and ingredients. We want them to have super clean products. So send her to mylola.com/rules40. All right, do it. Esther Perel, thank you so much for being here on Her Rules Radio.
My pleasure.
Your book, The State of Affairs, is incredible and amazing stories, such a good read, and it brings up topics that not many people are talking about. You wrote that there's one simple act of transgression that can rob a couple of their relationship, their happiness, and their very identity, an affair. And that's what this book is about, the state of affairs. And it's such a bigger topic than I had thought just looking at the cover. It's more than we normally think about. It's texting. It's porn. It's not just one night stands and full on secret relationships. Some people consider even masturbation to be cheating. So what is the landscape that you're talking about now?
So if I ask an audience, and I just came back from India, Costa Rica, and the Netherlands, so it's international. And I ask, how many of you have been affected by the experience of infidelity in your life? Because you are the child of parents, of a parent who fell in love with someone else and may have left or had a parallel life, or because you are the child of an illegitimate love yourself, or because you are a friend that somebody's been weeping on your shoulders for days, or the confidant of someone who's in the throes of one, or you're one of the three primary protagonists in the triangle of adultery. About 90% of the people raise their hands. So infidelity is ubiquitous. It has existed since marriage was invented. It's the shadow life of marriage. And it is often extremely poorly understood. But it is not just a few bad apples. It's intergenerational and it's systemic. And for most of history, it was kind of clear. It meant there was a baby that came out 9 months later. And generally, the color of the hair of that baby didn't resemble yours. And so we knew. But right now, the definition of infidelity is subjective. It's personal. It is no longer just mandated by major religious institutions. And it is infinitely elastic. It keeps expanding. So for what for one person is very much within the bounds, another person would say this was meant to be just ours. This is a transgression. This is outside of our lines. Lines which most couples rarely negotiate unless there is a crisis. I mean, you know, we could assume monogamy for most of history. Primarily, of course, monogamy meant that you were going to get married and sex, and you were going to have sex for the first time. Now you marry and you stop having sex with others. So people are serial monogamists. They are monogamous in all their relationships, but it's a very new definition. So when rules, you know, for most of history, relationships were regulated by rules and duty and obligation. So things were clear. Now we have a lot of freedom, we have massive choice, we have much less rules, and we have a lot of confusion and a lot of uncertainty and a lot of self-doubt. So all of this, the masturbation, the porn, the massage with happy endings, the ex on Facebook, it's all up for negotiation.
So in your book, do you talk about how couples can either renegotiate now that one person has discovered an affair, or maybe people are entering into marriage or a partnership and they want to be more open and concise with this discussion? Is that something that your book goes through in detail?
I think the book is so comprehensive that I go into a lot of things, and some of them more in depth than others. You know, it, in a way, it's a book about relationships through the lens of infidelity. If you want to know what is good, I'm going to show it to you by showing to you when things are really bad. I'm going to show you betrayal. I'm going to show you breach of trust. I'm going to show you lying, deception, duplicity. And then we will know, actually, what does it take to have a thriving and a strong relationship? But yes, I do talk about how you create a safe environment to have the conversations that are difficult to have, you know. And often people ask me this and I say, you know, you can say, I heard this woman, she was giving this radio show, or she was doing this reading, or I heard her on a podcast, or I read her book, or I saw an article. And I was wondering, you know, we've actually never talked about this. You know, it's like we pretend like we just came virgin to our relationship. We never talk about our life before. And I'm curious, do you ever think about it? Are you ever curious about mine? Are there things sometimes you wish you would ask and you don't? You know, I know it sounds a little crazy that we should be talking about desires for others once we are in our romantic bliss, because our romantic bliss presumes that, you know, we would never have any attraction for anybody else. But is it really true? I mean, or are we just pretending to each other and we lie? You know, gay men often walk a street and see somebody and say, see this one, hot, you know. They play with each other, and plenty of straight couples do it too, but it's not as easy, because the notion is that once you have found the one and only, the idea that somebody else could still enter your fantasy world, your memories, or your current attractions is instantly a sign that you're not enough, because you're supposed to be the one and only. That means everything. So we have an ideal that is precluding the conversations. It instantly distorts the conversation. If you bring it up, what, are you hiding something? Is there something going on that I should know? You know, that's the first thing, rather than, I'm so glad, you know, I'm glad you're bringing it up. It's not easy, but it's mature, it's adult, it's realistic, and it actually creates an open conversation so that we don't have to go and look necessarily for an opening, you know, of the borders itself. When people can breathe inside, they don't necessarily feel like they have to go outside to get fresh air.
One of the topics that comes up so much amongst my listeners and the followers, the women here, is that it's very hard to express themselves, to speak up. They've been trained to keep their opinions quiet or kind of, you know, negotiate with other people's energies before they say anything. And you even wrote in your introduction, you thanked your parents. You wrote, you know, thank you to my parents who taught me to speak up. And I'm curious, you know, how did your parents teach you to do that? I think it's such a valuable skill that many of the women who listen here are trying to learn for themselves, and they're trying to teach it to their children, especially their daughters. So this idea of, yes, we should speak up. Yes, we should be honest about what we really feel. But for so many women, especially, it's just getting the words out, the thoughts, is so complicated.
Right. But then I don't think that men do better in the emotional department. Look, couples these days have expectations piled upon them like never before, all relationships. I'm not just talking about long-term couples. And they are fairly isolated. They are totally, you know, nobody really knows what goes on in the life of a couple, which is part of, you know, I created a podcast called Where Should We Begin, where I do live couple therapy sessions so that people get to really enter a place where they never have entered. What do people really tell each other in the raw, intimate conversation? So that's a place where people can go and learn how to have these difficult conversations. It's on iTunes. And a part of it was because when you listen to others, you're standing in front of your own mirror and you're getting the words that you need for the conversations that you want and need to have. And I think that social media doesn't help either, because we're curating fictitious lives. So just about where do we find the authentic, real conversations at this moment about things that we never really needed to talk about before? And it is a learning. It's not something one is supposed to know. Often I tell people, write it first. Maybe you'll even send what you wrote and just say, you know, I will be trying to have a conversation with you. And I've been wanting to say certain things for a long time. And I realized that maybe I should try and see if I wrote, if it would come out more better. You know, sometimes, and because, plus we can so easily edit ourselves today, right? Throw the first version out. Just leave it. Then come back, write it again, and preferably by hand. And then just really say, you know, and I've been, sometimes when you don't pay attention to me, I begin to ask, are you thinking about somebody else? Sometimes when you don't pay attention to me, I wonder, are you still in love with me? Sometimes when you don't pay attention, sometimes when I don't pay attention to you, I realize that I take you for granted. I mean, it's not just what the other person does and doesn't do, but it is very important to write about wishes and longings rather than about criticisms and complaints. It is not true, actually, that women don't speak, but they often turn their wishes and their longings into criticisms and complaints. And then they produce a silent reaction or a reaction, a negative reaction on the other side. And then they start to feel like they can't talk because they're standing in front of someone who is either becoming animated or shutting down. But part of what needs to happen for women is a willingness to actually take agency for what she wants and say, this is what I want, rather than, this is what I don't like, this is what I don't want. Women do speak, but they speak from a certain angle. And it's always more vulnerable to say, I want something, because then you have to face the risk that you're not going to get it. But it is the direct route to getting it as well.
You mentioned writing by hand. Why do you encourage that rather than typing?
First of all, because typing takes away all sensitivity to your fingers. And because I actually met with a Hindu master, and he explained to me how much part of the Hindu tradition is to do the handwriting, and especially because the emotions come through your hand. And your handwriting is one of the most personal forms of expressions, something that is getting massively lost. And yet, you know, besides your face and your looks, the only other thing that was yours that no two were exactly the same is your handwriting. It is one of the most personal expressions of someone. And so I love the idea of it. And I know that there is a kind of numbing that takes place. Not that you can't write beautiful on, you know, I wrote a book on my computer, but there is something different when you write by hand and then you let it go if it's not good, the first one, because the first one is just to get it out. It's not, and then you begin to really say, how do I say this in a way where it can be heard? Not just what is it that I want to say, is what is it that I want my partner or my friends or my family to hear? What, you know, it's like when you write, you learn that the writing is not for the writer as much as it is for the reader. It's the same idea. So, you know, you start always by saying, this is hard for me to say. I've been turning this in my head for years. And I can't tell you how many times I've been hoping that I could one day put this on paper. I am scared that A, it won't be understood. B, you're going to get angry. 3, you're going to be dismissive. 4, you're going to ridicule me. 5, put in all the preemptives. And then say, now that I think I've put everything bad that can happen to me, I would like to dare to say to you, I would love if we, and then you just say your thing, which is often just a one sentence thing, you know. My parents taught me how to speak out. I think what they really taught me is not to take accepted ideas as a given. And to not just spout out stuff without ever checking it and just saying it because everybody else does. And to not be dogmatic, to challenge judgmental, dogmatic, narrow-minded thinking. That is where I think they said, go for the humanity. Go and look at, you know, what is the don't just look at the person because of their age or their physicality or their wallet. Go and look at their decency. Go and look at their sense of self-respect and dignity. Go and look at their generosity. And it was a very early lesson, often repeated, because my parents were themselves, you know, they were survivors of the Holocaust. They were in concentration camps multiple years. They were the sole survivors of their whole family. They learned to be real, real fine judges of humankind.
Fascinating. Do men and women cheat at the same rate and for the same reasons?
Well, the rate of men has not really moved too much, which is that it's been probably give and take depending on the definitions. There is no universally agreed upon definition of infidelity. So we don't know the numbers. And we know that women have every reason to be a lot more discreet and to hide much better than men worldwide. The consequences for women have always been much more dire. There's still 9 countries where she can be killed just for looking in the wrong direction. Men have practically had a license to cheat throughout history, and not because, you know, and then came all kinds of justifications that men are not by nature monogamous and all kinds of things like that. But basically, they had male privilege. They had patriarchy. And monogamy was an imposition on women. It was an economic issue so that the man would know which are his children and who will get the cows when he dies. The rate of men hasn't really changed. The rate of women has gone up 40%. And it has gone up because women have economic independence in the West, I'm talking, primarily. And more important than anything, they have contraception. For the first time, they can experience an intimate connection with someone without having to fear pregnancy or mortality. They have no-fault divorce laws that protect them. They do not have to fear the excommunication from the church and the big S letter. So, what has changed is not the women's motivations. What has changed is the consequences of infidelity on women. Now, for the motivation part, we've always said men cheat because they like variety, they get bored, they want novelty. And women must cheat because they are miserable and they are lonely and they are hungry for intimacy. And I think that that is probably quite misguided. I think that men seek love, but often love comes through them in the language of sexuality. And women seek often a sexual and erotic release. But of course, women have often waited till they were miserable and lonely because the consequences were so dire that she better be really miserable before she took the risk. When the consequences will be the same, we will know if men and women have different reasons to cheat. We don't know what women want. We only know that women have always done what they should.
You write that even happy people cheat. You know, people in good, solid, long-term, otherwise vibrant relationships, that it's not always a symptom of a flawed relationship or that an individual is broken or crazy or a misanthrope. So why, how is it possible? You know, I know women who have been in relationships where they're like, I can't believe he cheated. And I'm sure it goes the other way around. Everything seems so good.
So I think I would start from this. First of all, infidelity has become today one of the most painful, almost traumatic experiences in a relationship, of hurt, of betrayal, of abandonment. And it has become one of the leading causes of divorce, which is also one of the reasons I wanted to write about it. So this is not at all a piece of work that justifies anything or rationalizes it. It's really my attempt to understand exactly that. Why would people sometimes risk losing everything that they have built for a glimmer of what? What is it that people are chasing that would make them destroy and hurt the people sometimes that they love the most, including their partners? You asked me about women. There are themes that are different, and there are sentences, stories that you hear from women that you won't hear from men. For example, if a woman has an affair, she often will tell you, this is the first time in years that I'm thinking about me. This is the first time I do something for myself. I take care of him. I take care of his mother, of my mother, my parents, and my children. I'm a caregiver. This is mine only. That story of the venue for autonomy, the I am there for everybody else, and this is the one thing that is for me, is not a theme I often hear in the stories of men. It has a different take on it, but not in this particular way. I'm not a wife, I'm not a mother, I'm not a caregiver. This is the one place where I'm a woman. Again, not to justify, but to help us understand. And yes, I thought, you know, it's been so easy to say affairs only happen when the relationship is bad. No, affairs happen in good relationships, in bad relationships, in young, old, in married, not married, in straight, gay, and in open or not open, in non-monogamous relationships. So it's very interesting to understand what is the power of transgression. Why do people break their own rules and often are in conflict between their own values and their behavior? It's not like they're doing this and they're having one grand jolly time. They're often massively conflicted about it at the same time as they also feel like they are for the first time maybe actually honest with themselves. You know, they may be lying to the person that's right next to them, but for the first time they feel they're speaking true to themselves. It's a real massive quagmire. But the most important thing that I then found about that is this, is that some affairs have nothing to do with the relationship. And when a person is looking to find, to looking elsewhere, it isn't just because they want to leave their partner. What they want is to leave the person that they have become. And they're not looking for another person. They're looking for another self or other parts of themselves. The other that they're looking for is another version of themselves that they've been living with in one version for 20-something years, and they can't even remember. And they say, I once used to be. Where is that person? Do you know how many years it's been since? And what you hear is that affairs are about hurt and betrayal and duplicity and lying, but affairs are also about longing and loss and yearning for intensity, for connection, for aliveness, for vibrancy, all of those things. And that's what makes this such a powerful and painful experience, is that what it does to you and what it means for me are often completely at odds. And there are many, many kinds of affairs, of course. So, you know, the world of extramarital sex is vast. I am talking in particular about people, which is the majority of the ones that therapists see, who have often lived 10, 15, 25 years with somebody monogamous, faithful, happy enough. And then one day find themselves in a place they never thought they would be. That's the one that is really interesting. The chronic philanderers have been written about. The narcissists have been written about. It's like, what's to say that we know that? What I wanted was the majority, that silent majority that you don't talk about because they're not sensational.
Yeah, you talk about how affairs have a lot to teach us about relationships, that they're about pain and betrayal, but they're also about this self-discovery and this liberation that you're talking about. In my own first marriage, it ended because of an affair. And, you know, our inability as a couple to bring it back together. And looking back, it's wild that I can now say, I'm so glad that marriage ended. The way it ended was so painful, but it's a good thing for both of us that it did. And the affair was just a symptom of what wasn't working. Can you share perhaps a story or a quick anecdote about you know, maybe a man who felt the same way, like, oh my, you know, she left me for someone else, or we couldn't get it back together, or is this just something that you see regularly? Like, oh, people really discover who they are in a new way in this process.
Look, I've seen thousands of couples that have been shattered by this experience. It's so vast. But what I can say is that some affairs break a relationship, and some affairs remake a relationship, and some affairs stabilize a marriage. They balance it out. They make it possible to stay, and you cover the range. Some people needed this because it kind of justified for them that now they can leave. I've heard that, you know, it's like, I took everything. I took it that he was, or that she was never available, or I took it that, you know, I could accept that she was not interested in me, but when she went to be interested in somebody else, that was one too many. I accepted that he drank. I accepted that he was never home. I accepted, but then when on top of it, he had enough time to be somewhere else, that sealed it for me. That was one, you know, there is a way, I mean, in which somehow this one has become the justifier by which some people who take a lot, one, they finally feel like now I have the right, now I'm legitimately able to go. It has become the betrayal above all others. But the same thing is true in reverse, is that betrayal doesn't just come, you know, as an infidelity. It comes in many forms. And so the indifference, the neglect, the violence, the contempt, the other things that you think, why do people live with this like that? You know, it covers the ground, you know, Alex, it's so interesting that you wish you could say it's this and not that. But this is such a complex and multi-layered experience that we often wish we could simplify in good and bad, and victim and perpetrator, and it isn't. I wanted to go. I didn't go. But his affair finally made it possible for me to say, this is one too many. I kept hoping she would love me again. I kept hoping she would become interested in me again. But then when she took everything she had, you know, and she went and gave it to somebody else, I just thought, I'm just a function. I'm just, you know, what's my meaning here? Where do I stand? Do I even exist? You know, all she wanted was the lifestyle. All he wanted was the lifestyle. It had nothing to do with me. He got along with my parents so much more. He married my parents. He got the family he never had, but it had nothing to do with me. I mean, the stories are multiple. And that's what makes the book, I think, so riveting, is because there is not an invented word. Every word in there was told to me. I always say, I'm never sure that what I'm saying is right, but I can tell you nothing is made up.
It's true. There are countless stories in this book. It's remarkable. And I'm sure that for each one that you lay out for us, there are thousands that are just the same, that, you know, that everyone who reads this will find something that resonates with them. What about women who are the other woman? You know, I've had several very close friends who are involved in an affair, or they were the woman that was cheating with a married man. And I was kind of reflecting on that as I was preparing for our conversation. I find it really interesting in myself that I'm always on her side. I'm almost 100% believing this woman, friend of mine. You know, that her tale of his marriage is horrible, that he's finally happy with her and he's going to leave and be with her. And I know that so many other women can relate, you know, they support their friends that are actively involved in an affair. Are we doing the right thing? Are we doing, you know, are we giving our support in the wrong way? What do you think?
You know, there is no other man. This is a very important thing to know. And the other woman has usually in throughout history been the other woman. And sometimes she waits and he never comes. And he never comes, and he doesn't even come when she tells him, I won't wait anymore. And sometimes when she says, I'm not waiting anymore, he comes. And sometimes what he really wanted was his marriage and her, because that's actually the life that was balancing it out for him. And sometimes she says, I'd rather live like that. I get the best of him, or I get the other things that the partner does not. I've seen 30-year mistresses. I've seen them in many lengths. The difference of the other woman is that she doesn't just have a secret. She is the secret. And the question is, what does it do to a person to be a secret? And it generally does over time. It just wears on them. some have made a choice and they've learned to live like this and felt that, you know, they're not naive. I mean, I think there's so many things about thinking that they're 28-year-old and naive. No, they're women in their 50s and 60s. They're not naive. They know exactly where it's at. And they like a companion. They're not necessarily sure they themselves want another marriage either. So you have the one that's waiting for him to leave, and you have the one who actually doesn't particularly want him to leave. You have the one who would like for on occasion to have a weekend, on occasion to not just be so, you know, it's very codified where they can meet him. And, you know, we're talking now specifically in the role of the long-standing other woman. I wrote an entire chapter on them because I kept getting letter upon letter, hundreds. Don't forget us. Include us. We are part of the story. And I thought it's very strange that in the United States, most books about infidelity never mention the third person. And yet there is no affair without at least a third. I mean, you have to describe the triangle. I met a woman just in Amsterdam this week. And, you know, she began by saying, I read your book. You know, you saved my marriage. Okay, it moves me to tears each time. Here I am pregnant. This is the result. You know, after all these years, what I learned, I had to learn to reconnect with the woman that I had was no more. And he had to finally decide that he was going to become an adult and not start the whole thing all over again with a younger person. So he wouldn't have to, you know, make that leap. But, you know, I reached out to the other woman, and she and I today, she's no longer in the picture, but she and I today are actually quite befriended. I needed to have this woman, tell me who she was with my man, what she had, you know, what she had discovered about him, what I had missed. And instead of hating her and instead of, so, you know, you hear so many versions. You hear the one who I was going to shoot her. And then you hear the one of I went and I had to meet her and I know exactly who she was. I've seen many men who have gone to meet the other men. Often they like going as a duel, you know. You almost wish you could give them swords, you know, but what they really are going to find out is who are you and who are you that you got inside my woman in ways that I have no longer been able to reach my woman for so long. Who was she with you that I don't know? And when people go with those deep questions, those meetings are actually extremely powerful. So there's an entire chapter on the layers of the other woman, and many people have said that it's one of the most interesting chapters in the book, you know.
That's remarkable. Yeah, I was so really so grateful. I feel incredibly thankful that through a crazy series of events, my ex's wife and I we're not best friends, but the bullshit, the jealousy, the whatever, the anger is gone.
Right.
And now our sons, who are half brothers, you know, there's no boundary in between them or the energy. And I know that that's not possible for everyone. And believe me, it took me like 7 years to get to that point. But it's such a relief.
But you see, I think that story needs to be told. We are so quick at telling the horror stories, and we don't give people ideas of how this could be different and how to do it. Because family life goes on, because there are children in the picture, particularly the children. Because if every adult today stands to write the story for the future. It is the intergenerational legacy. It's not just your feelings in the moment. And many people, I think, when you actually tell them, you know, it could be different, they welcome it. They don't want to be eaten up by their vengeance and by their jealousy. And they wish they could free themselves from it. So I wrote an entire chapter on vengeance, an entire chapter on jealousy, stuff you never find in the literature.
Yeah. And you wrote about shame as well. And I really appreciated that. That is, it was a twist on it that I hadn't considered, that people who decide to stay after the affair. You wrote, once divorce carried all the stigma, now choosing to stay when you can leave is the new shame. And I thought, oh my gosh, that's so true. There's so much pressure for people just to get out. You know, he's an asshole or she's terrible. You can never trust her again.
That's right. Throw the dog on the curb. I mean, once a cheater, always a cheater. You can't take the spots out of a leopard. I mean, it just goes on and on. And as if that's the first time that somebody did something bad in the relationship, first of all. It also kind of precludes the whole story. But yes, I've seen so many women basically tell me they can't tell anybody because they will be judged for staying and for still loving the person who may have hurt them so badly, but they don't really want to leave him. Things are a little more complex than that. And so they lie. And so now they're holding his secret as her secret. And so now they're trapped into they're shamed once because he cheated on her and twice because it just is endless. And I just think it's so painful and not helpful. So I wrote a lot about the new shame. And I went even a step further. I said, you know, the point is not just to stay or not to stay. There's a whole lot about who stays, who doesn't, when it's time to go, what can be repaired, what can't be repaired, what are the various ways that people may choose to stay together afterwards, what will happen to the relationships. Because every affair will redefine a relationship. But every relationship will determine what the legacy of the affair will be. And so I think that what is really important is not just for the relationship not to die. It needs to come back to life. It needs to be a living relationship as best it can. And so, you know, I do a lot of work on rekindling desire. And it's not just desire in the sexual sense, as to how do you, you know, reinvigorate your relationship? How do you bring it back to be a thriving relationship? It's not, and that is the work on resilience. It's not just you overcome the betrayal, and you may not forgive. There's certain things you won't forgive. You learn to live with. This also I got from my parents, if you ask, you know, because my parents, they were betrayed by humanity in a way, right? They were not betrayed by their partners. And there are things they never forgave for that. But that didn't preclude them from loving again, having children, enjoying life, celebrating. They didn't just stay here on the earth for nothing. They were going to embrace life with a vengeance. And it's that idea. You don't have to forgive. You will say, this thing you did to me, I'll never forgive you. But next to that, I still love you, or I love you again, and I want this for us, and we will fight, and we will rebuild. And the notion that some relationships may even come out stronger, like from any other crisis, we know that, because they will have worked through things, because for the first time they will actually have really honest and open conversations like they haven't had in years. That also has to be told. You know, not for everybody, but the other story can't be the only story. So part of my whole work is helping people have thriving relationships. And because I believe that it's the quality of your relationships that determines the quality of your life. Nothing else that will match that.
Absolutely. You know, there's one final topic that I thought was so interesting. And this is, as you were talking about, the number of women having affairs has risen so drastically. And you talk about the new definitions of masculinity that are also emerging, and how many men are ensnared in these outdated, self-defeating ideals of male sexual prowess, or especially in this Me Too era. You know, there is, people are talking and people are, you know, finally speaking up, and women are finally being heard. How can we help men embrace a whole new suite of emotional skills that weren't, you know, traditionally a part of their repertoire?
Look, I'm hoping to write a whole op-ed about it coming up for Valentine. And for all the listeners, if you go on my website, there's two things actually that I think you're going to like. One is that I have an inventory of the 10 most important questions of relationships that I would love for you to try out. I think it kind of really is a distillation. But the other thing is that my next newsletter on Valentine will be on exactly this question. So for all of your listeners, welcome to join, and on estherperel.com. Part of what I'm going to talk about is this. We touch our boys much less than we touch our girls. This is to the women now, I'm going to say. Men and women, fathers and mothers and two mothers in same-sex relationships. We teach our little boys very early on to disconnect from their emotions, to become more fearless, to become more competitive, not to cry, not to let anybody bully them, to give it back to them, all of that stuff. We basically are teaching the code of masculinity from very early on. And we all are contributing to the making of the man that we then don't want to have. And I think we need to take responsibility for that. Many, many mothers are very afraid to have their boys be too sensitive, too feminine, too all of those things. Okay? So this has to start from very early on. But the main picture is this. The 20th century was the century where women's life changed. The 21st century will be the century for the men, because the lives of women won't change until the men come along. And that requires for the women to deal with the power that they sometimes feel ambivalent about, and the men to deal with their insecurity. Actually, the conversation should not be about male power and female weakness. It should be about female power and male insecurity, because that's the vulnerability space that men need to enter. And so I've been leading all these conversations lately, from 200 to 1,000 people workshops with men and women. And in the end, men are talking about their vulnerabilities. They're not talking about their power. Their power is often a defense, sometimes a lousy defense, against their insecurities. And so we need to go to the back door, not to the front row. You know, the front is just a facade of something that is much, much more, much deeper. And that's where the work will be done. And hopefully we will all start from much earlier. So we don't have to start with 35 or 55 year old. And that's the shifts that are going to take place. And they will take place. Norms change.
So if you could write a rule for us women who want to have a positive impact on the 21st century, what would that rule be?
I think there's many. If you want equality at work, you need to be willing to, you need to welcome equality at home, for example. You know, as a woman said to me, an 80-year-old woman said to me this week in Amsterdam, she said, at one point, I had three children because I suddenly got twins. I found myself with three kids and a husband who lost his job. And I had to go and work. And what she said is, I realized what it's like for the guys to have to constantly bring the check home and to have that pressure on them. I so resented it. And I so realized how few of them actually resent it. They have so internalized it that this is, they only have the shame when they can't do it. They rarely have the resentment that they have to do it. And for the first time, I understood something. I think that it is a certain kind of compassion that women need to have for the plight of men and not just for their own. Of course, when you say that, and women say, I've been, you know, all we do is think about the guys. But I'm talking about a certain kind of compassion. Nobody has it easy. I don't think that it's, that, you know, they celebrate and the others are just eating straw. You know, I think that in the gender configuration of the moment, there are wonderful things for both, but there are many hard things for all. And to not get into a victimization story. The men need to understand what it's like for the women to be in all the situations that Me Too and Time's Up is trying to tell them. And the women also can do some understanding of what it may be like for the men to be in the, you know, to get to the place. Not about harassment. I'm not talking in the narrow sense now. I'm talking about the making of masculinity. What is the masculine code? It's a very narrow. And the access for women to it is often easier for those who have sons, because you see it in front of you. You see what's happening to them. You remember them at three when they still have a full range of emotion. And then you see them at nine and you know what happens to the boys. And this is where we can enter. You know, we know by often that boys who have lived with single mothers and do much better in this domain because, you know, they were sitting at the table with somebody who wanted to have conversations.
It's so true. Yeah. Esther, thank you so much for being on the show. Your book, The State of Affairs, is a remarkable read. I really encourage my readers or my listeners to go get it and to check out your podcast and your blog at estherperel.com. Thank you so much for being here.
My pleasure. Thanks a lot.
Thanks for listening to this week's episode of Her Rules Radio. Come on over, follow me at Instagram at DeliciousAlex, or you can go on over to my website, alexandrajameson.com, and download your very own free ebook called How to Write Your Fuck It List. That's right. I have an amazing ebook that is all about a reverse positive psychology tool that I created. How to stop doing stuff you hate in order to live a life you love. That's right. I've taken all my positive psychology training and I've created this really fun workbook process that you can find at alexandrajameson.com and click on must haves and you'll find my fuck it list there. You can download it for free. It'll take you through a really fun process. Do it with a girlfriend. Download two copies. Have a girl over. Get clear on the stuff you're tired of doing and how you're going to flip that into something positive that you're going to do. See you here next week back on Her Rules Radio. Mwah.